I'm joined by commentator and lawyer Carolyn DeRusso and Labor MP Tania Mihailuk. Carolyn, Tania, thank you both for your time.
Pleasure.
Anytime, Chris.
Can I start with you, Tania? Let's talk about the issue of pork barrelling. Back in the spotlight again. Mm. You're not going to tell me that when in government, Labor doesn't do this stuff, are you?
Probably not as well. Look, I've got to say, Chris, the scale of this is out of control. This isn't pork barrelling, this is gold plating. $1.9 billion to Liberal-held seats, in contrast to $530 million to Labor-held seats. A very glaring example is the southwest Sydney seat of McMahon, where the household median income is about $85,000. That community only received $650,000 of federal grants, in contrast to North Sydney, that received $23 million and Wentworth at $33 million. Now, North Sydney and Wentworth are two of the richest electorates in the country. And look at what they receive from this government. Now, this doesn't just happen at a federal level. I look at the state Liberal government. 84% of community grants were divvied out to coalition-held seats. 92% of school grants to coalition-held seats. The Liberals, both at a state and federal level, are perfecting the art of pork barrelling, and they have no shame in that regard.
All right. Carolyn, does this kind of attack resonate with voters, or do you think governments have a bit of leeway on grants to electorates?
Well, I suppose in a sense they do have a little bit of leeway, and what Matt Canavan was talking about earlier is a very good example of that. Something like drought relief, that is obviously going to be really targeted simply because it is drought relief.
Yeah.
But, you know, Chris, I'm a taxpayer. The average taxpayer does not want to see any government wasting or misusing or whatever any sort of money. We don't like waste, we don't like excess. Is it going to be something that is going to change a vote? I'm not sure that it is, but it's something that all governments at all levels of all stripes do to an extent. And today, oh look, Chris, I don't generally turn onto Sky for comedic value, but today Christina Keneally was on with Kieran Gilbert talking about how the federal Liberal government was rotting and was rotten to the core. And I thought to myself, does this lady have amnesia? Because, Chris, she sat propped
Let's play,
on top
just before
of
you
one
go,
of the
Carolyn,
most
let me play
putrid
the grab.
Government.
Let me play that grab for viewers who didn't see it. This is Christina Keneally today.
This is a government that has got warts riddled throughout its budget. No wonder it's been more than 1,000 days since Mr. Morrison promised a national integrity commission and has failed to produce it because his government is rotten to the core.
Has she forgotten about the party she once led?
Apparently she has. Anyway, she was sitting up there like Jackie O today, full of chutzpah about, you know, the way the Liberal government is conducting themselves. And look, you know, there are ministers that were in her government that are now in prison for capital C corruption. And at that time, New South Wales had an ICAC in place. Mm. So, look, I would like to see something. I would like to see some sort of body, whether it's an ICAC or whether with the existing bodies that are already there, that there's some sort of rationalisation of terms of reference and powers to make sure that everyone is keeping a good eye on politicians. But at the same time, let's not pretend like it's some great deterrent, because evidently the New South Wales ICAC, with teeth and all, did nothing to deter Mr. Obeid and his friends.
That's very true. In terms of grants that went to particular electorates, ICAC has done virtually nothing. To the Sydney seat of Wentworth and independent candidate Allegra Spender, Tania, she's just secured $300,000 in donations, which is not bad for an independent. Meanwhile, the Prime Minister says a vote for independence is a vote for Labor. Tania, there's a real pile-on from independents who seem solely focused on wiping out the Morrison government, don't they?
Well, I'll begin by saying, Chris, I reject the suggestion of what Morrison has said in suggesting that this is the voices of Labor, because when we look at a seat like the Wentworth, there are wealthy people from a wealthy electorate who were historically part and parcel of the Liberal Party faithful, OK? Let's be honest. And they are now turning on their own. So what Morrison has before him is his own people, really, in many respects, turning on him. And it looks to me like, and I mentioned earlier the pork barrelling in Wentworth of $33 million. I'm not sure if it's going to pay off, but clearly this is a huge problem for Morrison. He has an area where people have wealth. They've got a lot of support. A lot of traction in the media and the social media. And I think you'll see that that seat will be a marginal seat for Morrison and a huge headache for him.
It already is a marginal seat. Now, Carolyn, the former Liberal supporter who has since been dumped, Simon Holmes at court, this is his revenge. He is out to take them down, isn't he?
Oh, look, perhaps, I don't know. I mean, I'm sure he's in the background and I'm sure there's an illustrious few others. Tania does make a little bit of a point that I do agree with, is that, you know, I don't necessarily agree that they're in place of Labor. I actually think, you know, they are that what is now that kind of real champagne socialist. They're more Greens in Gucci than they are Labor, Chris.
Spot on. Good description.
You know,
former Liberal Party
voices
faithful.
Of Wentworth. not really, because I'm a small business owner, and trust me, the Liberal Party faithful are really quite a different breed. But what we are seeing here, we are seeing the voices of the entitled and the upper middle class, and you know that there is a very different thing to really what you would call your capital L Liberal voters.
Yep. Another hot topic in the news today: transgender guidelines. A new poll has found that Australians are in favour of restricting women's sport to biological females. I can hear the woke brigade firing up from here. But, Tania, anything but biological females, let's be real here, it's clearly unfair, isn't it?
Yeah, look, it is probably a question of fairness, and I'm sure the science is probably not indeterminate in regards to all the different hormonal changes and so forth that a person goes through. But I've got to say, when I read this article today, Chris, I noted that there was a senator there, a Liberal senator, that was proposing some law change. And I thought, wow, at the end of the term, they finally decide they want to do some law change. I've got to say, it looks to me like this has been raised because somebody might be up for a Liberal Party pre-selection in the Senate. I don't see why this is a pressing issue. I've not had this issue raised with me at any time when I meet with my sporting groups in my electorate. So, look, there could be an advantage, could be a disadvantage, but I just don't think this is at the forefront of people's minds.
I thought after the Olympic Games in Tokyo, I thought there'd be a greater conversation about it because there was some unfair competition that led to the winning of medals. It's not discrimination. It is just trying to put in place fair competition in a men's sport and in a women's sport. And we know for a fact that men who become women end up having a far greater muscle mass and a very different configuration of hormones. Mm. Carolyn, it's an issue worth talking about, isn't it?
It is an issue worth talking about, and to be fair to Senator Claire Chandler, this is something that she has been talking about for a long time.
Yes.
I think the reason that we don't have as much conversation around this is because of the strength and, quite frankly, the belligerence of some of the trans activism that goes on. I mean, you look at the silencing of someone like J.K. Rowling over a very similar issue, and she just got absolutely burned. So I think it is correct, and I think it is a conversation we have to have, but I actually think it's a conversation that we're either not ready to have yet, or people are a bit scared to have, because people are scared to have an opinion on this for fear of being cancelled.
I don't like that.
I think that is probably actually the problem.
Yeah, I don't like that. Say what you think. Forget about being scared of what you think. Carolyn DeRusso, Tania Mihailuk, thank you so much for your time.